When General Napoleon Bonaparte invaded Egypt in 1798, he brought along 167 experts, les savants, in all fields to chronicle the mysterious land that he wished to make France's own. While the French military occupation ended in 1801, the great intellectual enterprise of describing Egypt only appeared in 1829 in 10 magnificently illustrated volumes. They served as the foundational texts of Egyptology and the European rush to know the Orient. The Dahesh Museum exhibition, Napoleon on the Nile, Soldiers, Artists, and the Rediscovery of Egypt, tells the story behind the story. Egyptologist Bob Breyer navigates the Nile for Canape.
The exhibition is very ambitious. It has several sections. When you walk in, you'll see documents from Napoleon's expedition, letters he wrote. Then you leave that section and you come to another area where you see the publication that resulted from it, the Description de l'Egypte, one of the largest and most fabulous publications in the history of the world. When we leave that section, then we start to see engravings from that publication. We see beautiful views of the pyramids, of the temples. You've got another section which shows natural history. It shows minerals, plants, birds that they recorded. And then just around the corner, there's another section which shows Egypt of 1798. It shows mosques. It shows the Muslims praying. It shows their arts and crafts. It shows all of Egypt as it was when Napoleon was there. So there are several sections, each one dealing with a different aspect of the Egyptian campaign. Most people don't realize it, but Napoleon didn't win in Egypt. He lost. And part of the reason that most people don't realize it is that Bonaparte was very good at spinning his own news story. When he returned from Egypt, he had been defeated. He knew it. His men were dying of the plague. They were being attacked. It was a disaster. And he knew he was defeated. But as soon as he got back to France, he had medals struck, which said, the hero returns to his country. He had medals showing his victories in Egypt. And he even minted one that's wonderful. You'll see it here at the Dahesh. It's one of a crocodile chained to a palm tree, which was the symbol of Egypt being captured. So Bonaparte said, I won. And who knew the difference? Because there weren't newscasters, there wasn't television. While Bonaparte was claiming that he was winning in Egypt, the British knew the truth. He was losing. And in Egypt, one of the great caricaturists, Gilray was his name, was doing these wonderful cartoons of Bonaparte's men dying of the plague, you know, but they were still studying crocodiles and things like that. And they did one of Bonaparte with his sword, you know, which says Egalite, but it's dripped in blood. So Gilray was doing his own sort of spin on what was happening, and I think his was more accurate. One of the amazing things about Napoleon was he's going off to war. He's going to a country he's never been to. So he assembles his army, but he has another thought. He takes with him 150 savants, scientists who could study the birds, study the plants, could study the ancient monuments. And he has this whole commission of arts and sciences that he's bringing with him to study Egypt. It is the first anthropological study in the history of the world, and it's Bonaparte's idea. Bonaparte's scientists were only in Egypt for 3 years. But for 3 years, they were drawing and recording every aspect of Egypt they could. When they returned, they published the most fantastic thing in the history of the world, called the Description de l'Egypte. It described all aspects of Egypt. And one of the great things that the Dahesh has here at the exhibit, for the first time ever, is a painting, which was actually painted by the publisher of the Description de l'Egypte. He was an artist. His name was Pankouk. And he published this fabulous painting, which shows all aspects of Egyptian antiquity. And then it became the frontispiece for the Description de l'Egypte. So at the exhibition, you know, visitors can see both this fabulous painting and the frontispiece as it appeared in the Description de l'Egypte. When the savants returned and published the Description de l'Egypte, Europe got its first accurate view of what Egypt antiquities looked like. For the first time, they saw a very realistic drawing done by a professional artist of a mummy's head. And also even things like a mummy's arm, just the arm. And one of the things I like about the Dahesh exhibit is that they've got the Description de l'Egypte engravings, you see the mummy's head, you see the mummy's arm, and then they've got the actual arm of a mummy. And it's a very touching thing to see this arm of a mummy. It was a young woman. It's a small arm, but it's an adult woman. But on the wrist, painted, is a little bracelet. And what that means is she wasn't wealthy enough to be buried with a bracelet for eternity. So someone painted it on her wrist. It's rather a nice touch. When Bonaparte's men returned and they published the Description de l'Egypte, we get really the beginnings of academic art. This is professionalism. They are sort of describing things accurately and trying to get everything right. And the world goes crazy over it. They love it. But then for about 100 years, it's sort of lost. But now people are returning to it. They're looking at it and they're saying for the first time, wow, look at that. Isn't that great? And I think people are starting to see it and say, gee, I never saw that. Isn't that wonderful? So I think one of the great things about this exhibition is you're going to see some things that you've never seen before. You're going to look at it and you're going to say, wow, that's different.
Duke Ellington always said that his music was beyond category. The word jazz wasn't adequate as a description. The same kind of problem follows any attempt to quickly describe the music of Serge Gainsbourg, who died 15 years ago. His compositions have had such pervasive influence on contemporary French music that some fear Nogol can do him justice. At least, that's the take of a new recording, Monsieur Gainsbourg Revisited, a tribute compilation of cover versions recorded by a dazzling array of international artists. Producer Timothée Verrecchia tunes Canape to the station.
Serge Gainsbourg is the epitome of the French artist in the sense that he's a Renaissance man in the most French way possible. He was a painter, he was a composer, songwriter, he was a lyricist, he was almost a poet. Some would say he was an actor, he was a director. He was just the best-rounded artist of the 20th century. We were speaking to a number of different artists, Anglo-Saxons, who in the past 5 or 6 years have been referencing Serge Gainsbourg, and it came to our mind that Serge Gainsbourg was relatively new to this audience, and also not only was it new to them, but a lot of them had, for most of them, they didn't have access to his lyrics and they only listened to his music. So they really had a fresh ear on Serge Gainsbourg's music. So originally what we did is we went to the Gainsbourg family and told them about our initiative and told them that we really wanted to translate his work. His work had been translated before into English, but never with the approval of the family. So for us, it was the first step. The artist that we picked to be too reverent or too intimidated by the music. So we gave them the raw material and said, you have carte blanche, go ahead, play with it, deconstruct it, build it again and stuff.
I know a few of his songs, but just from his vibe, I could tell the guy was way ahead of his time. He's a legendary, a legend, he's like Bob Marley, John Lennon, Jimi Hendrix, all these people.
C'est l'album classique. C'est un petit peu comme un dieu anglais, c'est qu'un vache sacré. Un petit peu. J'avais envie d'attaquer quelque chose d'aussi sacré.
What I really liked about Gainsbourg is the fact that he doesn't give a fuck. It's a bit of provocation and it's a bit of punk attitude. Gainsbourg was a punk, basically.
We really wanted a mix of people. We really wanted the work to be legitimate in the sense that we wanted people who had worked with him, who knew his spirit, also with the people behind the scenes, the producers, the engineers. We even went and recorded in studios where he had worked. We really wanted this to be a Serge Gainsbourg environment. As far as the younger artists are concerned, We went to people who had either referenced him or spoken about him in interviews, or whom we guessed, you know, somehow knew his work or admired his work, which is the case for The Race or The Kills, who were the younger bands on the record. We really wanted to be a quality record, and we knew the kind of people we wanted to have on the record. So this wasn't a record label driven project. It was really a labor of love. Our endeavor is really a small project, but we really wanted Serge Gainsbourg to be able more accessible to everyone. So if the young generation of artists 5 years down the line, you know, make a record and say, we discovered Serge Gainsbourg through this record, it would be the best recognition for this project, I think. You remember the good times and you cry. Suffocating your face so pale. Now the hour is nigh.
This is the story of
the great French filmmaker Jean Vigo died in 1934 at the age of 29. He left behind the masterpieces Zéro de Conduite and La Talente, works that continue to enchant worldwide audiences. He also left behind a spirit of independent filmmaking that has been commemorated since 1951 by the Prix Jean Vigo. Past winners include Alain René, Claude Chabrol, Anne Fontaine, and Olivier Assayas. The Museum of Modern Art in New York is offering a rich retrospective of the winners. Curator Véronique Godard and past prize winner Jacques Champreux join Canape for a chat.
Eh bien, Baco l'autre rive, je peux dire d'abord que c'est le film qui m'a valu le prix Jean Vigo, dont je suis extrêmement fier. Le prix Jean Vigo, c'est un prix qui n'est pas un prix de consécration, c'est un prix, je dirais, de prospection. Il s'agit de découvrir non pas un film, mais un metteur en scène prometteur. Alors, j'étais cette année-là le metteur en scène prometteur avec Baco. Baco, c'est un film sur l'émigration africaine, l'émigration illégale, clandestine, du Mali à Paris. On a suivi, avec une équipe très légère, du départ à l'arrivée, tout le parcours d'un clandestin. Mais c'est une œuvre de fiction. C'est une enquête qui a été menée et à partir de laquelle j'ai écrit le scénario. Donc c'est une sorte de patchwork, une fiction construite à partir d'une sorte de patchwork, de morceaux de vérité. Mais je crois que d'abord, le nom même de Jean Vigo est symbole pour tous les cinéastes français, enfin, un peu conscients des valeurs artistiques du cinéma, et symbole de liberté. Il n'a jamais accepté la moindre contrainte. Ce qui fait qu'à l'époque, il n'a pratiquement fait que deux films, un long métrage qui est La Talente, et un court métrage, c'est un moyen métrage qui est Zéro de Conduite. Zéro de Conduite a été interdit, et La Talente a été remontée de façon scandaleuse à l'époque. Et il n'y a que de nos jours que l'on peut voir La Talente et Zéro de Conduite. Et c'est pourquoi c'est un exemple pour tous les cinéastes. Mais il faut accepter, courir le risque d'être occulté.
Thank you. Jean Vigo was the son of an anarchist, of a Catalan or at least a Spanish anarchist who left and finally died in a jail. I believe that when Jean was small, he was born in 1905, so when he was young, he was very inspired by the memory of his father. So he wanted to make the revolution with images. Every directors I met when I prepared this selection, every young and less young directors were totally honored to be awarded with the Prix Jean Vigo because of the spirit and because of the still the independence and the liberty of the of making films. So that's a little the reason.
I got the Prix Jean Vigo with my graduation film from film school, a short film with two actresses that have now become quite famous, one of which is my sister, Hélène Filière, who is an actress, and the other one is Sandrine Kiberlin, who is a pretty famous actress in France. It was her first movie part. And the Prix Jean Vigo is very well renowned in France, and it really helped me to make my first feature film.
Toi, tu préférerais être obligé de faire piquer ton chien tout de suite,
ouais.
Ou rouler une pelle au prof de maths pendant une minute?
Bah, faire piquer mon chien tout de suite.
T'es dégueulasse?
Bah, écoute, c'est toi qui es dégueulasse de me demander ça. Bon.
Mais toi, tu préférerais réussir à sortir avec Thibaut?
Ouais.
Mais rater ton bac? Ou alors réussir à avoir ton bac avec mention sans jamais réviser, mais jamais sortir avec Thibaut?
Putain. Je crois avoir mon bac avec mention.
Ouais, moi aussi. Toi, tu préférerais qu'on se voit pas pendant 6 mois ou que pendant 1 an, t'aies pas 1 centime d'argent de poche? Ni se téléphoner?
Non.
Ben, pas avoir d'argent de poche pendant 1 an?
Ben, j'espère.
Bon, tu préférerais...
Non, c'est à moi.
Tu préférerais prendre 10 kilos et jamais réussir à les perdre?
Ouais.
Ou traverser Luxembourg en maillot de bain de pièces, mais sans le haut du maillot?
Traverser Luxembourg?
I was aware of what was the public in the MoMA, and I was sure that it was the right place to put such an extensive retrospective every 15 days, twice a month. And my feeling is really, I am very moved. I am very proud. I'm very happy because I attend the first screening in February, and it was very moving to see lines at MoMA. So I really hope that this new fall series will be exactly the same. They are beautiful films. They are very good films by Rosier, by Bernard Kessan and Georges Perec. I really hope that the members and the cinephile and the student will come every 15 days.
A leading artist of world music, Manu Chao plays music that can be heard around the world, mixing rock with Latin, African, and Middle Eastern styles. His songs address key experiences of two-thirds of the world. These are the hundreds of millions of people who live outside economically developed regions. His music travels well because he travels to know the world well. One of his recent stops was New York City, where Canape found him playing for a global audience in a global city.
¿Qué pasó? Venice Radio Bemba, last gig of the tour. Everything went really okay. We're really happy with all the people we met around in all the country, with the shows, with all the new friends we met. And last gig in Brooklyn, it's a dream for me. I'm happy.
Are you ready, Brooklyn?
Live music is live music, so I think the first thing important when you're on stage, then one word is energy. And what we need to bring first the energy from the stage, after the energy goes on the crowd, or vice versa. And there's this kind of little dynamo that's going on. And when the dynamo starts working, that's a good show.
Cuidado en el mar, cuidado por la sed, cuidado donde sea, que te andan buscando, cuidado en el bosque, cuidado la frontera, cuidado donde sea, que va complotando, peligrosos
important aussi de voir les États-Unis de l'intérieur à un moment où, enfin, moi personnellement, et je sais beaucoup de gens, on est extrêmement critique sur la politique des États-Unis et de leur gouvernement. Mais il ne faut pas mélanger ce qui est le gouvernement des US et ce qui est les gens qui vivent ici, quoi. Donc il y a beaucoup de gens ici qui ne sont pas non plus d'accord avec la politique de leur gouvernement. Et pour moi, c'était important de venir les voir maintenant, quoi. For me, the important is the future, is not the past. The past was my school. I built my personality with my past, for sure. I try to do my best in my present. I try to be, most of all, an honest person in my present. in my everyday life, in my music. And after, that's the only analyze I do myself, try to be honest. Esperando la última ola, Pachamama.